Welcome to the Animal Training Fundamentals Podcast, where we have fun with practical application and we get mental with the science of behavior. Put them both together and you get results, solutions for your behavior problems, and the tools you need to achieve your training goals. I'm your host, Barbara Heidenreich. Let's talk training. Hey guys, thanks for listening to the Animal Training Fundamentals Podcast. I hear we're ranking pretty well under the nature category, so if you haven't subscribed yet, please do hit that button and join us. Become part of our community here. I also wanted to jump in here before we get right into our topic because I'm starting something new. Some of you may have noticed that I've been answering your animal training questions. If you'd like to submit a question, all you need to do is go to the podcast page, or you can go to animaltrainingfundamentals.com/smlinks, and you'll see a place where you can submit your question there. And I'm answering them on social media, and I'm also trying to pick nice ones that I can answer in the podcast. And ooh, I have got a doozy for this week. It has to do with bridges and terminal bridges, which kind of ties into questions about keep going signals. I'm saving it for the end, so you're going to have to wait till the end for this actual question and discussion. So hang on, let's dive into the topic, and then we'll get right into that super cool question. Hey, animal training enthusiasts, it's Barbara Heidenreich here, and I have a special guest with me. I have Annette Pedersen from the Copenhagen Zoo, and we've got a very fascinating topic for you this time. I like to call it every animal counts, because they certainly do. This time we're going to talk about training animals that you might consider domestic animals, or maybe animals that you work with in education programs. Sometimes they're not always domestics in those education programs, but the things that we're usually handling for education programs, or animals that you might consider part of a farm or domestic animals. So welcome, Annette Pedersen.
Thank you, Barbara.
Now, let's talk a little bit about some of those traditional methods that people have used to train animals for education programs and sometimes in the domestic area. What's been your experience, Annette? What have you seen in the past when people maybe, let's start out with those animals in education programs. What did you typically see in education program animal handling in the past that didn't sit very well for you?
First of all, I think that often it was more about the education or what the teacher needed than was actually the animal welfare. So what I saw was people coming in with boxes, and they needed like one snake and one guinea pig and a couple of mice, and they put them into these small boxes and put them on a wagon, and they would just be there, be ready to be shown to the children or to some presentation in our children's zoo. So people could come and see a snake. And, you know, they took the snake out and held it out. People could touch it, put it back in, and that was what it was.
Yeah, I would have to agree. That's kind of been my experience as well over the years. I actually started out in educational programming in the first zoo that I worked in. And I have to admit, that zoo was relatively progressive even back then, which was many years ago. My job was actually to train animals to load into crates and things like that. But over the years in consulting, I've certainly seen places where it was a little bit more of the grab and go variety, where it was just, hey, we got a program to do. I'm just going to pick up this animal. It might mean herding it into a corner. And when you talk about things like guinea pigs and rabbits, and what I always saw with rabbits, that was a big indicator to me that a rabbit wasn't comfortable being picked up, was the tension you would feel in their body. Even though they might hold still and you could pick up that rabbit, you would feel the muscles all tense up. And that was always an indicator to me that this animal's just tolerating it. It's not really comfortable with what's going on there. So with my own rabbit, I really focused on training that animal to voluntary load into a crate. And you can teach animals to be comfortable with being picked up, but a lot of times I much prefer that they just load into a crate themselves. And one of the things that I did with my own guinea pigs was to train them to load into crates as well. And I put that into a DVD, but you guys took it to another level with your guinea pigs, which I thought was really, really awesome. Would you care to share that story?
Absolutely, I will. And I like you say that grab and go, because that's exactly what I also thought, and if they bite, they were problem animals, and they had to be exchanged. I mean, there was actually not much thought about how the animal felt. I have to say that I went to an APMA conference in 2013 in Toronto. I saw a presentation made by a guy called Will Brunner from San Antonio, and he talked about education animals or demonstration animals and how people use them and what we should consider. And he had this, I thought it was a great presentation. And it was videotaped, so I took it to Copenhagen and I showed it to the keepers that worked with the guinea pigs. What did it take? About 20 minutes later, they called me from the education section and said, "Oh, look, we have already started training our guinea pigs." They were so inspired by this presentation. Absolutely felt we could not no longer defend chasing the guinea pigs up in a corner, grabbing them and bringing them to education sessions. So then we started working on it. I mean, how do we get these guinea pigs to participate in a better way? And we were around different kind of solutions, like trying to make them go up on our hands voluntarily, but it was very difficult to control these guinea pigs. And we had to come up with some kind of solution that could be used by all the educators that was going to use the guinea pigs for the classes. So what we came up with was to train the guinea pigs to go into a crate. And in that crate, we put a little hammock, a little sling, so a piece of fabric. So when the guinea pig went up in the crate, we could lift it up in that little hammock and place it on the children's legs, on their thighs, and they could feed and they could touch the guinea pig from there. And what we saw after we trained them was that instead of having an animal doing a freeze behavior, because that's what they did, and we also filmed that, so you can see the animal, the guinea pig is just freezing up totally and not able to eat or anything when they were out with the children. But as soon as we trained them, they are eating, they are looking around, they're curious. You can see their whole body just are totally different.
I agree. And we can put some video of that on the episode webpage so people can see what that really happy, relaxed, comfortable guinea pig looks like when they load up into that sling and then they're sitting on the children's laps enjoying their lettuce. And the children get the opportunity to experience that guinea pig up close and in person and comfortable and relaxed.
Yeah, and they get to feed them too when the animal is actually eating.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And they get that connection, which is the goal and purpose of these education programs.
Exactly. So what are we trying to teach the children? That's very important. It's an important message for the children.
I 100% agree with you. I think when we do these education programs, you know, a lot of times we have people saying things while they're talking about these animals, but their interactions with the animals speak something different. And so if we have an animal that's uncomfortable with the handling that's going on, and the animal, if we're talking about a hedgehog, and that hedgehog is balled up because it's uncomfortable and it's showing a defense posture, or we have an animal that's trying to escape because the handling is aversive, that sends a very completely different message to the children, basically that it's okay to harass an animal so that you get the opportunity to look at it, versus that one that's voluntarily participating and it's comfortable and it's relaxed and it's getting positive reinforcement for participating and enjoying the interactions with the people. It's gaining trust with people. And that's really the message we want to send. You know, connecting with nature or even domestic animals, any animal for that matter, is really what we're aiming to teach people, and having that respect for animals and wildlife. Hopefully, with that kind of approach, our message comes across, even with our physical actions, as well as the words that we're sending to the people.
Absolutely.
In addition to the handling, when I was there last time, your team had also trained some other behaviors with the guinea pigs that I thought were pretty cool. Didn't they also do a vocalization on cue?
Absolutely, yes, they do. When we whistle, all the guinea pigs start screaming.
Oh, yeah, they make that little squeak, squeak, squeak that they make when they know they're about to get food. So if anyone has a guinea pig as a pet at home, I'm sure you know this very familiar sound. When they know it's feeding time, they start squealing, anticipating food. And the team at Copenhagen put that on cue. But what's even more fun is that you have the guests do that, the cue, right? It's not the keepers. They can have the guests do it and the guinea pigs will make the vocalization. and then they give the guinea pigs the lettuce.
Yeah, and the difference from what it was, how it was done in the earlier days. In the earlier days, we took a guinea pig out of the crate where they go together, maybe 10 guinea pigs together. And they took one guinea pig out and they took it away from the group. And then you just waited for it to call the group because it wanted to go back. So the kids could hear how does a guinea pig sound. But we don't have to do that today. Today we can just ask all the kids to be very quiet and then whistle. And when the kids whistle, all the guinea pigs starts to squeak.
And then they get the lettuce. Back.
Yes, they get the lettuce.
Another thing I noticed that I think is really interesting for those of you that know anything about guinea pig behavior, guinea pigs can be pretty tough animals. So when you are trying to introduce a guinea pig to another group of guinea pigs, it can be really difficult. There can be a lot of fighting that goes on. And one of the things that I noticed in your housing setup there that I thought was really, really fascinating, guinea pigs can't really climb or jump very well. So you don't really have to have these high walls or anything. So you have these low, I don't know what to call them, like a bin, but they're quite large and they're on wheels. And you have these low, big giant bins, for lack of a better term, but you also have sort of a screen barrier in between the different bins. And so there's three of them, as if I recall correctly. And you've got your groups of guinea pigs in each of these three bins that can be next to each other with the screen barriers. And with those screen barriers, the guinea pigs can smell the neighboring guinea pigs. And because of that, I asked one of your keepers, you're actually able to move guinea pigs between bins and not have a lot of fights or tussles because they still smell each other, which I think is fascinating.
That's true. I asked the keepers about that and they said, of course, they can still have a bit of fighting, but it is nothing like it was before. I mean, they're much quicker accept other guinea pigs because they can see and they can smell each other.
That's really an important little bit of information for anybody that knows anything about guinea pig natural history, because if they're just separated, no visual contact, no ability to smell each other, and you try to put two together, it's a big nasty ordeal. It can be a lot of fighting. It can be really, really nasty. Animals can really get hurt. So a very interesting little tip there. And again, I'll stick a little video clip on the episode page of the guinea pig squealing on cue, so you can see that and you'll see the setup when you take a look at that video clip. Cool.
Yeah.
Anything else to add about the guinea pigs?
Yes, actually I have, because we have a very new experiment, or actually it's an old experiment, but we are trying to do it in another way today. It's for school children that comes in and learning about metabolism and the oxygen use in guinea pigs. So we have these acrylic boxes where we put the guinea pigs in, and there's some air coming in and some air coming out, and it measures how much oxygen the guinea pigs are using within a specific time. And then they check up on all the results. It's a research project, yeah. Before, we just took a guinea pig and put into those acrylic boxes. They are transparent, so the guinea pig was just sitting there. The keepers didn't really like that because they had no cover, and they felt that the guinea pig felt very exposed and wasn't very comfortable. So they came up with the idea of training the guinea pigs to go into a fabric crates with a bit of straw in there, and they could lift the guinea pig and put them in the acrylic box in those small bags. Then after that they have measured the oxygen use from the guinea pigs that were in the bags and guinea pigs that were not in the bags, and trained guinea pigs versus non-trained guinea pigs. And it turned out that the trained guinea pig, actually, if you measure the use of oxygen and compare that with stress levels, they could see that the trained guinea pigs in the first trial was more stressed than the not trained guinea pig. But the next trial, the trained guinea pig was much less stressed than the not trained guinea pig. So it was easier to get used to new surroundings and accept them than guinea pigs that has not been trained. Does that make sense?
Yeah. That's why we do those kind of research projects, right? To help people understand that training with positive reinforcement really makes an impact.
Yeah, we talked about it. And the only thing we need to measure right now is an untrained guinea pig that has never been in the box, and put that in the box and then measure the oxygen level for that guinea pig. But it seems like that the trained guinea pigs adapt to these new circumstances much easier than untrained guinea pigs.
Wow, I love it.
But let's see about that.
Yeah, right. Got to keep collecting the data, right? And do some analyzation of all the results there, and before you put out that paper.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Cool stuff.
Yeah.
What about some other animals in the education area that you've been training? Do you have some other stories to share?
Oh, yeah. I've been working with a veterinarian in Copenhagen University. We've done some work with research animals and trying to find training methods for them. And then I came around this 3Rs.
So the 3Rs is an organization that is promoting animal welfare for animals that are in research and laboratories.
Yes, it is. And the 3Rs, I looked it up today, and I know what it stands for. The 1R is a replacement, and that means that they suggest that as much as we can, we should replace animals, research animals, with something else like stuffed animals or computers or similar alternatives to use of live animals. And the other R is a refinement, which means that we should not just try to reduce suffering and distress in the laboratory animals, but we should also try to optimize the animal welfare. And the next R is reduction, and that means that we should use as few animals as possible, but still get the correct data, of course. So you have to use enough animals to make sure that you get the data you need, but not more than that. Because if you use few animals, and you don't get the data you need, you have actually wasted that few animals' lives in the research. So they're doing a lot of good work trying to reduce stress and optimize welfare. I came around a poster that was on the veterinarian's wall, and that was something about tube handling mice and not grabbing mice by the tail anymore. So I started looking into that, and I found that there's been a lot of research on what happens to mice when you grab them by the tail, and probably other rodents too, rats and stuff. It turns out that it actually affects their behavior a lot. They get fear response towards humans and towards environment. They become very fearful and they don't behave normally. In the lab world, it's actually very common that you do not grab mice by the tail, but you use tubes to train the mice to go into the tube and being transported in the tube and be picked up by walking in the tube. And then they just pour them out in the hands of the researcher. And you see a totally different behavior from these mice. They're not afraid of people. And also they can use a technique called cupping, where you kind of scoop up the animals by lifting them with your palms. That's also a way of taking mice, lifting mice out of their cages. So I was kind of embarrassing to learn that we actually still were grabbing the mice by the tail. So when I knew about that, we bought tubes for all our mice cages, because every cage needs its own tube. So now we don't do that.
And they need
anymore.
Their own tube more because of the scent and the smell, right?
Yes.
They don't. Other rodents are not going to respond well when they have a tube that came from another animal's enclosure, right?
Yeah, and it would not be as easy to get them to go inside as it would if it's their own tube. So
yeah. And I remember you showing me a very cool video from a laboratory where they showed a rat or a mouse, I don't remember, that was picked up by the tail and put into a maze. And when it was put into the maze, it froze when it was picked up from the tail and put down. And then video also showed a rat or mouse that had been in a tube and then they let it crawl out of the tube into the maze and immediately started exploring. So what was really fascinating about that is that there's probably tons of research papers out there, even on cognitive stuff and behavior. We're not talking about other types of research, but even on behavioral stuff where animals probably did not show what we would consider normal behavior just because of the handling techniques, which I think is fascinating. Absolutely fascinating.
And think about what it does to research. If the animal is not behaving right, how much can you count on that research?
Yeah. Is that data accurate? Not necessarily. Not necessarily. Mm-hmm. And a simple thing like that, that a lot of people don't think of as a big deal, it's not a big deal to pick up an animal by the tail, is a huge deal. Absolutely huge deal. You just impacted that animal's behavior tremendously. So now think about that when you're handling an animal for an education program and you thought it was no big deal to just scoop up that animal by the tail to put it on your lap to show a kid. It actually was a huge deal to that animal.
Exactly. That was really surprising for me. That was such a big deal.
And you actually have that poster on your wall in your education program, right? With information about why people should not pick up animals like that and the proper techniques to use to pick up the rats and mice.
Yeah, and the same organization actually made posters of rats, mice, and I think rabbits' facial expressions of how they feel. And you can get it for free to go in on that website and you can just download it or write to them and they'll send it.
Cool. I will provide links to all that on the episode page for this particular podcast. Anything else in the education area that you want to talk about?
Yeah, we have lots. Like the ferrets, they did a lot of training with the ferrets too, like letting them load into crates voluntarily. So if they wanted to go, they could go. And sometimes if they didn't want to, they just stayed in their cage. Also, they were not grabbed. They put the crate on the floor and the ferret went out. It was target trained to go through a very long tube. I think it was 3-4 meters to see how they move in tunnels. And it was transparent. So then the children could sit with the tube on their lap and watch when the ferret ran by inside the tube over their legs. And the ferret, of course, came out in the other end. And then it was target trained to go around the children and they could smell the ferret and they could touch the ferret and the ferret then loaded into the crate.
I like that tube on the legs because that's also a nice safe way for them to interact.
Yeah, they can be bitey, but it wasn't a big problem when we started using the target training. We have tortoises in the education room and they have learned to go down a ramp. So when the keepers put a ramp to the crate, they are elevated like 20 centimeters above the floor. So they have this ramp they can put up to the cage and let the tortoises go out themselves if they want to. And it's really funny to watch, especially the tortoises that are in the cage next to it, because it's like with the guinea pigs, they can see what the other ones are doing. And they really want to go when they see that ramp. They go down on the floor and can walk around in the education room with the children. We have tenrecs.
Okay.
They climb a rope. So if they want to go, they get a rope presented. So if they want to come out, they can climb the rope or they can stay inside. And then they climb up to a branch that are attached to a plate that you can put on the table and they can climb around up there. Children can watch it.
Well, I don't think I've seen a tenrec climb a rope before.
Oh, they're very good at it. What else? Hens recall using a squeak toy. So they react to the squeak toy and can actually go to the education rooms for stationing or jumping on tables and fly down so the children can see how they fly.
Yeah, chickens are great. There's so many things chickens can do. When we did a show back many, many years ago on Disney's Discovery Island, our whole backstage area was netted in, and although it didn't matter for the chickens, but we used to let the chickens out just who were in the show, but they would run around our whole area, and we never knew where they were. They were taking a dust bath somewhere or just foraging around looking for bugs. And we would use a clicker as a recall, not as a bridge. And if we clicked it a bunch of times, all of a sudden chickens would come running out of the bushes and run back to us for worms. Yeah. So that's how we would find our chickens when it was showtime.
That's what we do at night. They go to the restaurant area to pick up French fries and stuff like that. So when we have to get them back, we just squeak the toys and back they come running.
Yep. So if you got backyard chickens, you should be training a nice recall on your chickens. You probably already have, I guess, as most people have.
It's hard not to, I think.
Yeah, I know. They learn quick. So where are the snakes? You told me earlier you had some snake training going on.
They have this box that they put in. It's more like for feeding the snakes. They feed the snakes in a plastic box. So instead of just feeding them and hope they are hungry, they present the box. And if the snake is hungry, they are fed in the box. And if they don't go into the box, they are not fed. So they know they have to go into the box to tell the keeper, I'm hungry, I want some food.
Oh, nice. I like it. And these are non-venomous snakes, right? Because these are part of the education.
We don't have venomous snakes in the zoo at all. We are in a process where we really want to do some training with the snakes, but I'm not sure exactly how to do it. We're working on it. But right now we are more looking at body language, learning a lot about snake body language, what to look for when a snake is not stressed, when it's moderate stressed, and when they are a lot stressed. And actually we have the Danish Associations of Zoos and Aquariums have a meeting on Friday where we talk about training reptiles and fish in that meeting in our national aquarium. And we will talk about snakes at that meeting too. So hopefully there will be more snake training in the future. We also have rabbits actually in the education area and are training them to enter and leave their crate when asked.
I think that's really important with rabbits from my personal experience, because a lot of people do just pick up rabbits, but in my experience, they really do like to have their back feet solidly on something, because it's just like with guinea pigs, this is the way that those animals get away from something they don't like. They use their feet to run away and escape. And when their 4 feet are all off the ground, I think they feel very vulnerable, and you'll often feel them tense up, like I was saying, with their muscles. And so even though rabbits will lift their forelegs off the ground, they're usually okay with that. But when you lift those back ones off the ground, they tend to feel very uncomfortable. So I think teaching them to load into a crate is a lot more comfortable for them than it is to pick them up. Even though you can train them to be comfortable with it, I think they're a lot more comfortable with loading into a crate voluntarily. But speaking of rabbits, your zoo is very famous for your rabbit recall training.
Yeah, that's right. We put out a video. A very nice video of a rabbit recall. The keepers made that in the morning when she came down to feed the rabbits. They go outside in a big area on a small hill. And at that time, we had a lot of rabbits, on, I don't know, 13, 15 rabbits. And just rattling the keys, you could actually call all the rabbits inside for their breakfast. And that was cute. And we still do it, of course.
Very nice recall training videos. Do we have that to share?
Absolutely.
And we'll put that on the episode page as well, because I'm sure people would love to see that one again. It's a favorite around the world.
Very good recall video. It's where you don't think recall, connect to recalls, can be done with everything.
So what other animals are being trained over in the farm or barnyard area of the zoo?
We're doing a lot of horse training. We train the horses for agility. We talked about that. So I don't know if you want to go deeper into that today.
I think maybe what we should do, because we did a whole podcast on about training horses for agility with Annette not too long ago, we're going to refer everyone to the wonderful podcast on training horses for agility, because we go into it in quite a bit of detail. I think you all should check out that podcast, but we can state it here that the horses are trained to do agility at the farm over at Copenhagen Zoo. And it's not just about having a good time with the horses. It's really about benefiting the welfare of the horses. I think that's important to mention.
Absolutely. It's fitness for horses. And now we even had Nina Steigerwald, a horse person from Germany, visiting us in December. She was actually bringing a gift for us, a Christmas gift. One of her biggest teeter totter that she makes, and she taught us some new moves and how to make the horses benefit as much as possible from the movement. Actually, they don't have to move very much before it makes a big difference in their muscles.
Okay, and definitely check out that podcast on the horse agility so you can learn more about why it's beneficial to horses and all the details on why the zoo decided to train horses for agility. All right, so what are some other animals that are being trained?
We have been training one of our pigs for injection. And that's a bit special because we didn't just train it for injection, actually. We were training it because I was teaching some courses along with this veterinarian for research animals. And a lot of medical companies uses pigs as laboratory animals. They have them in normal sized holding areas, maybe 3 and 4 pigs together. And even though, and I think we should respect them for that, because even though some of the pigs are only there for 2 weeks, in research, they still want to do as much for them as possible. So the medical companies don't want to go in and grab them and inject them. They want them to teach them, train them for voluntarily injections. And I think that's pretty cool when you only have an animal for 2 weeks. We tried to make something that could help them train 4 pigs in a time as fast as possible. So we created this tube that you could attach on the bars so the pig can come and put his nose in, and we can feed through that tube so the pigs couldn't fight over the food. You could not get bitten in your fingers. You would actually teach your pig to station at the same time. It was very easy to teach them duration because they knew exactly where the food was coming from, and also they positioned themselves easily for injection in the neck. It was more like trying to help them that we created this system, and I'm sure we're going to continue with that because it really works. Otherwise, I would love to do what I've seen on your videos, Barbara, with the scratching, but that again takes some relationship between handler and the pig, and it may have taken too long for these kind of animals.
Yeah, the scratching thing is just one option, obviously, and it's not going to work in every situation. And some pigs don't even really respond to scratches. So I loved seeing your pig injection, and I got to see it live and in person not too long ago, so I can share the video clip that I have of it. And I think it's an absolutely fantastic idea, and I think it's a great solution for, especially when you have multiple animals in the same space, and you, like you said, dealing with competition for food, and gives them a station. So yeah, I think it's a great idea. I absolutely love it. And as you and I both know, there's a million ways to get to a solution to the same same, you know, behavior goal. So I'm all for it. One way that I've shared is not the only way to do something, for sure. So yes, I love that idea. So who else have you been training? Don't you do some stuff with your cows?
We do halter training, of course, because we need to put them on halters because we sometimes take them out for a walk in the zoo and also just to move them around. But we clicker train them to wear a halter. We have once trained calf for euthanasia with a bolt gun. And it was a very special event. Of course, it's hard for the keeper that does the training and also ends the calf's life eventually. But there's no doubt about it that this calf has had the most welfare the whole way through. So we feel good about that.
So I know that's we're just touching on that here, a very, you know, intense topic to talk about, but I did prepare a presentation for the Animal Behavior Management Alliance conference about training animals for euthanasia, which I think is something that's worth talking about. We train all these animals to have a great life, but then we don't talk about what happens in those last moments. Yeah. And in my opinion, I think it would be a tragedy for your animal to have this wonderful life, and in the last moments, everything is stressful. So what Annette is talking about there is an animal that was destined to be euthanized for a number of reasons, and they didn't want to do it with a chemical euthanasia. They wanted to do it without chemicals, and so they trained for the procedure, and that is addressed in that particular presentation, and it is a humane euthanasia. all those details are in the presentation about training animals for euthanasia, which is in the online education program and animaltrainingfundamentals.com. So yeah, so I think it's a deep topic, probably another one for another podcast. And of course, also in the course there. Pretty important training. Moving on probably to more happy topics, I suppose. What else do you have over there? I'm trying to remember now.
Llamas.
Oh, yes, the llamas. What are you doing with the llama?
We also train them for halter, and they have also been trained to lie down and have their feet checked and target training.
And I also remember when I was there, this is just a normal everyday thing. I also really love that you guys, when you give an end of session signal, that you always leave something lovely for the animals to engage in when the keepers exit, so that the animals view keepers exiting as a good thing and not a bad thing, and that, oh no, when keepers exit, all the good stuff ends. And I remember seeing that with the llamas. That was where I know you do it with a lot of animals, but I remember specifically seeing when the session was over with the llamas, they got a lovely, wonderful buffet of things as the keepers exited. So another thing that you do with those animals there is you have a nice good thing that happens after your end of session signal.
Yeah, we always do that, not to create problems with leaving for the animals. You know, first there's a lot of activity and suddenly the train is gone and nothing happens. So, and also the keyers, when we trained the keyers, they started attacking us. Yeah, well, they kind of said it themselves. They get some enrichment when we leave, so they have something to engage with.
yep. Something good that lasts a while, not just a peanut and like there you go, because that ain't gonna gonna do the trick.
No. So we do that with all animals. It's a zoo rule.
Yeah, I like it. It's a good rule to have. Who are all the fabulous people that are training these amazing animals in education and in the farm area?
In the education section, we have two lovely keepers, Anne Christensen and Sigrun Rasmussen, very Danish names, sorry for that. But they're doing a marvelous job with the education animals. It's really extraordinary. And the same goes for our children's zoo keepers. It is Rosa Nielsen, it is Nikolai Rød, it's Anne Krabbe. In Dave's piece, we call her Krissa. We have Daniel, and we have Anne Rostel, Daniel's Heinz in the surname, and Anne Rostel, who are the fantastic children's zoo team.
Awesome. Well, I highly recommend, if you are in Copenhagen, that you visit the Copenhagen Zoo and take a look at all these amazing animals and the things that they've learned how to do, because it's just fabulous and inspiring. If you don't already know it, Annette is a wonderful teacher as well as the animal training coordinator at the Copenhagen Zoo. Is there any place that people may catch up with you soon on the horizon?
Yeah, very soon. If you're in Holland in March, you can come and say hi at the EASA Forum in Appenhall. And the week after, that's in the end of March. I think it's 24th to 26th of March. And the 29th of March, the ABMA conference is in another place, also in Holland, Bexabergen. That will be the ABMA conference until the 2nd of April.
Well, I will be sure to post those also, links to those on the episode webpage, so that people can catch up with you and talk about animal training with you live and in person. Thank you once again, Annette, for sharing all your knowledge and experience with us here on the Animal Training Fundamentals podcast.
Thank you for inviting me, Barbara.
Okay, I promised you I'd answer an animal training question, so here it is. Do you use an intermediate bridge? And if so, do you use a separate conditioned stimulus than your terminal bridge? Okay, that's the basic question. And then just to make sure I had a little more clarification, I kind of asked if this was about a specific behavior and how they might be applying that, just to get a little bit more visual, because I don't know about you guys, but I like to have a visual about how I might be applying that, because it helps me think a little bit more clearly about what people are trying to achieve by using a strategy like this. So the example that was given to me was, if they had a mountain lion and they were training the mountain lion to put the paw on the fence, could they say good while the animal was holding the paw on the fence throughout the behavior? So for example, say good, 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 and then at the end of the behavior, blow the whistle to say, you're done, you can take your paw down, you've completed the behavior. So the good would be like an intermediate bridge, and then the whistle would say, yes, you've done the behavior. And then another example would be, say, for example, the mountain lion is supposed to walk through a tunnel that's 20 or 30 feet away and saying, good, 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 as the animal is walking through the tunnel. And then when it reaches the final destination, blow the whistle, you've done it correctly. And so the question really is about, should that signal, good, 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 be different from the whistle, or could it be the same signal? And then also in that question is, should you even use that good, 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 good along the way and a separate signal at the end, or should you just use the signal at the end? So a great question, in my opinion. Let's get into this topic. So it's actually a pretty complex topic because we're having to look at a few different things. Some of those things are, what exactly does a bridging stimulus mean to your animal? And a bridging stimulus can mean a lot of different things, and it depends on what you teach your animal that thing means. And in this particular case, if we use the same signal for this, quote, keep going signal, that would be one thing that you're teaching the animal this signal means, if you were using it to mean keep going for the middle of the behavior, and then at the end of the behavior you're saying it means, oh, you've completed the task correctly and here comes your desired reinforcer. This is one of the challenges with the bridging stimulus. It's such a complex topic. In fact, I did a workshop on this in Copenhagen not too long ago where I talked about that this signal can mean so many different things. It depends on what you teach your animal it means. So in my opinion, definitely I would not use the same signal for one. So that's the first thing that I would throw out there. Using the same signal is absolutely confusing because you can teach the animal that that signal means 400 million different things. A bridge can mean the animal has met criteria but is not released from the position. It can mean duration has been met and the animal is released. It can mean different types of reinforcers are about to be delivered. It can mean a different type of response is desired. It can mean a specific type of reinforcer is coming and is not related to meeting criteria. It can mean I want you to stay in this exact position, or it can mean I want you to do another kind of behavior that sets you up for the next behavior. So think about like the animal that needs to sit on the station and wait for the trainer to come to it to deliver the reinforcer. Think about the animal that does the behavior and then has to return to the station. There's so many different things that a bridging stimulus actually does signify. So if you're using the same signal, where in one context it means keep walking in the direction that you're walking, but then when the animal gets to that destination, it means stop and stand still and wait for me to come to you to deliver food, that's very confusing, right? You've basically taught the animal that that signal means two different things, and how's the animal supposed to understand, oh, now it means this, but now it means that? Very, very confusing. Okay, so there's one aspect to the question. But here's the other thing that I would be asking myself. So then the next thing we need to think about is the other aspect of these two behaviors is duration, right? So keeping the paw on the fence is a duration behavior. Continuing to walk in the direction that the animal is supposed to go is a duration behavior. So how do we tell animals to keep doing behaviors? Is there a continuous signal that says maintain doing what you're doing? And if that signal goes away, then you're off track. That's one way. That's the Bob Bailey way of a keep going signal. Is it focus on a desired item? Is it follow a specific thing like a target? Is it anticipation of more desired consequences? Is it your shaping plan? You've actually built duration by gradually adding on increments of time. Have you used an intermittent schedule of reinforcement to create that duration? Have you created that walking that distance by maybe you've just created the action, maybe you made a little scent trail or a little food trail, you've lured it until eventually the animals learned, oh yes, I should just stay on this trail, and eventually when I get to the end, oh, that's when I get the real goodies, all the good jackpot, so that's why I'm going to continue on that trail. Basically, it's a duration behavior. Create the duration. And then the question is, what tells the animal to stop doing the behavior at the end? Is it the bridging stimulus? Is it reinforcers are delivered? Is there a cue for another behavior? Is it an end of session signal? Does the continuous signal stop? Are there other environmental signals? You move, you walk away. Criteria is met because, you know, they understand from past experiences, yay, you know, I've learned it. Extinction, the animal gives up trying. What tells it to stop? So really what it comes down to is that if you've created duration using the strategies that we normally do use to create good, solid duration behaviors, you probably don't need an intermediate bridge or keep going signal. Your animal's going to understand how to do the behavior. And just to recap, we wouldn't use the same sound as your bridge because the bridge can mean many different things. It depends on what you teach the animal the bridge means. And under this particular condition, you're kind of teaching the animal that there's the bridge means two different things. And the other thing that we haven't talked about is that actually teaching a quote keep going signal, which is what you're trying to do with the intermediate bridge there, requires training a concept that you're actually asking the animal to generalize. And this is not an easy concept. You would actually have to create the situation in which you teach this concept, which requires you setting that up and training that concept. It's a little too in-depth for me to go into right now. Steve White, who's a dog trainer, has a really nice presentation about how he did that with some of his police dog work. And in the long run, he said it wasn't really quite that worth it, in his opinion. He didn't think it was really all that helpful to his work, which is pretty intense work. So in my opinion, in the zoo community, just train some good duration, you know, work on training duration, and you will find that that is not even necessary. So for me, I go back to break it down into small approximations, do some great duration on it, and use your bridging stimulus as you would in most behaviors, which is it occurs basically once the behavior is completed. And once that behavior is completed, it bridging stimulus probably means either come to me or remain at your place where you end up at the end of the behavior, and that's where reinforcers are going to be delivered. So for me, I'm kind of in the camp of there is no need for intermediate bridges, and just bridge at that end of the behavior. So there you go. It's a complex answer. I have to admit it's kind of long and involved. But like I said, I've prepared this in a PowerPoint presentation that I did for a workshop at Copenhagen Zoo. So I have a lot more on that. I haven't yet put that in the education program, but it's probably going to happen because it really was a really good presentation that goes into this a lot deeper with a lot more video clips and examples helping to illustrate those points that I just made there. So hope that answers that question. Again, if people have more questions about animal training, visit animaltrainingfundamentals.com/smlinks and you can submit your questions, and I will do my best to answer them either on the podcast or on social media. And yeah, that's going to do it this time around. Be sure to subscribe to the podcast, and we will look forward to talking training with you again next time. If you liked what you heard today, visit animaltrainingfundamentals.com for more quality content on animal training. You'll find courses, community, and extensive video examples from my consulting work around the world. We'd love to have you join our force-free family.